bonfires were burning beside almost every town and village during the times known as Reformation. Thanks to those fires, the old books, in which the genuine history of humanity was recorded, was erased. Small groups of Jesuit monks made copies of those old books, and on those copies is based what you have learned in school during the history lessons. Sadly, your history teacher forgot to mention a very small detail that the monks honestly wrote in their books, that they are not making exact copies, but they are actually copying and correcting the text so that it will fit the most modern for their times and new idea of what history was. And that's why the content of the official history doesn't fit the artifacts and the historic sites. This so-called history didn't come as a result of scientific research or something recorded in the old chronicles. It was imposed with military power, aided by extreme cruelty. For those who are not satisfied with this imaginary history, here in this video I will make an attempt to make a new timeline of the history of our planet based on the actual artifacts and historic sites that we have at hand, instead of speculations or so-called old books. Contrary to common spread beliefs, sophistication, technology, and everything else that we tend to label as advanced or civilized is nothing that evolved recently within the last couple of thousand years, but it was probably always there on Earth, coming and going away at different locations at different times, like the waves of the ocean. And that is why machine parts show up in very ancient layers, like for example these spirals, they clearly bear marks of machine work. Or for example, this imprint of what nowadays we would call an aeroplane wheel was found almost a kilometer deep below the Earth's surface in coal layers, which according to the official mainstream geology should be some 300 million years old. The day after this amazing find was made in the Donetsk area of Ukraine, the full mine was submerged in water and closed down. We are lucky to have these images because a worker took them with his cell phone. In US as well, concrete wall was found very deep in the earth layers, and I believe again on the very next day the full mine was closed down and filled up with boulders. But speaking in terms of actually accessible ruins dating from those faraway times of extreme antiquity, probably most of them would be already unrecognizable due to the prolonged erosion. Like for example, these stones from Sweden, it is hard to say, are they ruins of something or a natural formation? The oldest surviving ruins we have are those of rock-cut underground dwellings that are found all over the southern parts of Asia and Europe, and to some extent both Americas. These rock-cut cities are so vast, especially in the region of Asia Minor, that we don't know. Were they designed to support many millions of people of population, or we can talk even about billions? In many regions of nowadays Turkey, there is a similar ruin almost next to every town and village. Although most of these dwellings appear to be primitive, especially because they are so heavily eroded and because chisel marks are often seen on them, still the civilization that dug them out was in no way primitive. For example, at the bell-shaped gigantic grottos in Israel, the tool marks that appear on the very high ceilings appear, according to some people who have studied them, to be machine-like. And then in Spain I noticed these curious maybe tool marks on the floor. Possibly some tool was used to scoop out the stone, because very similar marks are found also in Peru. This is from Peru, this is from Egypt, and then very similar in Russia. But no matter what kind of tools were used, engineering and building all these underground networks, sometimes multi-floored, is not something that could be done by primitive people. Just look at these complexes of giant holes. Savages who have never seen a comb in their life cannot design and carry out projects of this magnitude, as mainstream penguins often try to assure us. And that's when they are kind enough to even accept them as man-made. As they did in this particular case with the grottos of Polignano, it is not uncommon for them to simply put a sign, interesting geological formation, and in such a clever fashion to avoid even discussing them. But by far the most common trick used to distract the public attention from this amazing network of rock-cut cities, metropolises, is to give the credit of building them to the cultures that were reusing them throughout history. For example, this would be listed as some sort of Christian church, without mentioning a word that it is located in a complex, extremely ancient complex. Another way to make the common people unaware of the existence of this almost worldwide network of cities is to make up fantasy names, often absolutely fraudulent and misleading ones, but always different for the different regions. For example, in Hungary they are telling, oh, somebody must have been breeding bees in them. Israel and Turkey were supposedly full of villagers who were breeding pigeons in them. In Spain, the monks were supposedly building them to meditate in them. And in the area of the Balkans, they are called Thracian altars. And people believe all this because they are shown only a very small fragment of information, only the local one. They are not being informed that there is a uniform worldwide network of cities of uniform style, which happens to be extremely ancient. Ruins of this style are found submerged as low as 80 meters below sea level. And lots of the ruins bear no connection with the current earth level. On the floors of some of them, we see petrified formations that are usually found at the bottoms of oceans and seas, where the sediments petrify after very long periods of time. Sometimes vertical columns that are found inside the rooms of these underground cities, in rooms that are not directly exposed to outside weather, even those columns are so heavily worn out by the elements that only hints are left from them. At a number of places, the very geological layers of the earth have been moving and shifting after these cities were built. They are much, much older than anything built, all the monuments from the last few thousand years, which are more or less near the current earth level. Don't just believe me, think for yourself what kind of earthquake would have been needed to flip this size of boulders. It is highly preposterous and even laughable on the side of the penguins to try to convince the public that this has been cut in the rock in the last 1 or 2,000 years. And then in certain areas of Turkey, in the vicinity of the rock-cut very ancient cities, there are extremely ancient vehicle tracks. Whether the rock-cut cities and the vehicle tracks are connected is yet to be found out, but one thing is sure, these tracks were left in soft mud. These images are the ultimate proof. And there are imprints of lots of activity going on besides the tracks. Lots of activity, but not a single human or animal footprint. So it is time to admit that basically we have very little, even general clue what was going on our planet in deep antiquity. And just to avoid misunderstanding, not all ancient tracks were left at the same time period, and not all of them were left in soft mud. For example, these tracks are obviously on a paved road and are surprisingly sharp as well. And then we have the tips of the giant castles of Egil sticking out of the waters. For me, those are some of the most remarkable historic sites on Earth due to their extreme age. What portion of them is underwater, we don't even know. But they give us a rare glimpse of the towers of buildings built many, many thousands of years ago. I think that is absolutely amazing. Since the title of this video reads timeline, probably many of you would be expecting more years in terms of suggested information of how old all this could be. But in reality, if we have to be honest, we don't have even a single reliable historic or geological method of dating all this. And then at the site of Illyros, Greece, we have a similar cone-shaped, maybe roof again, sticking out. Inside it's got a chamber. Taken separately, this is neither extremely exciting nor very meaningful. But once we make the parallel that this resembles exactly, actually it repeats exactly the shape of the roofs of the castles of Egil, then we can start making the hypothesis that this was the architectural outside style of this absolutely enormous network of underground cities. Another site that may give us a valuable clue as of the looks, the external architectural looks of these complexes is Iolantas. It is hard to say, though, if the animal figures belong to the original, very first rock-cut cities here, or they were a result of the subsequent renovations and remodeling attempts. Yes, the situation with the rock-cut cities is extremely complicated. For example, those in Turkey, they were initially built by people of our size and later on used by dwarves and who knows whom exactly. And in Crimea, we have even a more interesting situation. Over there, we have completely distinct two generations of underground city building with vast gap in between them in terms of time. I don't know what that vast gap would be in reality, but if we trust the mainstream geological dating, that gap could be even number of millions of years. Well, I personally don't trust it, but sometimes I quote it just to give a general relative idea. And speaking of the really oldest historical remains, in this very same area, maybe we have samples of the oldest pieces of art. I dare to suggest such a hypothesis because near Avila in Spain, again in the vicinity of an area very rich in ruins of ancient rock-cut cities, we have the bulls of Avila. So in both cases, the statues are in proximity with rock-cut complexes. In both cases, they are very, very eroded, and in both cases, they don't fit in the subsequent art styles of the cultures present after that. At this point, you might wonder, what about those small statues that they were showing us in school, telling us that they are the oldest form of art found on Earth? Their age also looks very impressive, more than 30,000 years. First of all, we don't have that much reliable dating method to be sure that they are dated properly. And second, if we assume that these dates are correct, then this would be simply the oldest examples of simple or primitive tribal art, which is a nice style. I mean, people make such things even nowadays. That's nothing new. But what is unfortunate is that when sophisticated and very old pieces of art are found, they cannot be examined and categorized properly by the penguins, because the penguins also have some sort of penguin knowledge and experience, simply because they will not fit in the fairy tales that they are preaching, and that is the best case scenario. Probably the most interesting pieces of art simply disappear before people even get to know about them. It is normal to have very old artifacts with simple tribal art. Even now, tribes exist in the remote regions, in the jungles. The problem is that when you tell only half of the story, eventually it turns into a lie because it hides the existence of other, more advanced segments of society on our planet. The proof is not only their ancient depictions, like this one from the Marquesas Islands, but also the fact that we regularly find buildings, structures, and artifacts that have required advanced technology to make. In many cases, even technology that surpasses our current level of so-called advancement. Here we have a depiction of green rays from Sigiriya. And it's not just the high-tech artifacts, also the maps, the old maps made with digital accuracy depicting the continents as they were found a very long time ago, for example, Antarctica without ice sheet. If the human race wants to know its true origin, first of all, it should stop considering the legends, fantasies of simple people. The legends are our history. They are confirmed by the artifacts, and also they are found in very similar versions on different continents, which is yet another confirmation that they are not made up, they are not fantasy, they are just common man's record of our past. Try to calculate yourself what would be the mathematical chance of simple folks living separately, not connected to each other, in America, in Egypt, in Asia, in Europe, all of them to have the same dream, same fantasy, that some sort of strange beings land from the stars or come out from the ocean and they're half human, half amphibian or something like that, and then to have the exact same fantasy that they made with them, and even the end of their fantasy is always the same. The offsprings, the result of such unions, they always become the rulers of their kingdoms. And on the top of that, the simple man who had absolutely the same fantasy, although they were separated by oceans, which they supposedly could not cross, and then they decided to make this fantasy their historic record, respected by their tribe. Well, I think the chances are somewhere around zero. There are just too many similarities to call all this coincidence. The legends are confirmed by the artifacts. We find skulls that are not human. For example, this elongated skull from Bolivia, it has a completely different design. It's not just what they call human deformation. It's an entirely different thing. Also, recent DNA tests of elongated skulls, this time from Paracas in Peru, they have shown non-human origin. So before even discussing any particular historic events, one should first get right at the basics. That the human race has been interacting with beings from other spheres all the time, and that has influenced our historic development profoundly. Or to be more precise, they have simply shaped our history. And probably the second oldest type or class of ruins would be the so-called elf castles. They are also primarily rock cut and heavily eroded like the underground cities, but they are connected to the current earth level. They are found all over Asia Minor and Southern Europe. Without any doubt, they belong to a single civilization or culture. For example, look at these stone niches. One is on the Balkans and the other one in Germany. As if the same stonemason cut both of them, or people looking at the same architectural projects cut them. Even small details like the size of the border in the front, they match. And also the rectangular cuttings inside, they are also practically identical. Even the borders I see are again of uniform size. Officially, they were cut by stupid villagers who didn't know anything that is more far away than the tip of their own nose, but to speak of traveling or connecting to the people on other continents. And this is just a small example. Actually, all the other architectural and design elements, they are absolutely identical all the way from Israel to Portugal. Countless rectangular cuttings with sizes starting from half a meter and reaching, I don't know, maybe even 20 or 50 meters. With identical borders, they're just found by hundreds, if not thousands, all over West Asia and Southern Europe. Officially, they're always attributed to various mutually unconnected primitive tribes on various continents, but the sophistication of these castles shows that they are not the work of primitive people, and the design similarity shows that they were a product of a single cultural civilization. And although they are primarily rock cut, we start noticing the tendency of megalithic blocks to be used. Sometimes they're rather large, bigger than trees. It's not sure were they quarried or were they cast out of a geopolymer, because sometimes we see the blocks connecting with each other in a funny fashion, like here for example. But we see this tendency to use megalithic blocks in the better preserved ones, the better preserved elf castles. The last few examples were from Turkey. Actually, there are a couple of videos on my channel about the elf castles specifically. Highly recommended.
And also at Papatakon. The whole thing is rock cut in large boulders. But when carefully examined, these large boulders are actually megalithic blocks. Now notice the grid on the floor. This is where the blocks meet.
Actually, the megalithic blocks here are so big that the people who live in a tiny matchbox-sized universe of reality, who have confined themselves to such a small world view, they simply cannot not see them. They just see the medieval tower on the side, and then they are told that the rest is mystery, and everything gets dated because of one single tower which is indeed in medieval style, but the large metropolis-sized complex around with absolutely huge megalithic blocks. What about that? Well, that simply remains under the radar because of the extreme erosion and the unshakable belief that school history is science. And here we are back to Turkey, where the megalithic blocks were somewhat more obvious, but look at the floor. Same, it looks like the floor of Perpetikon. Megalithic blocks the size of rooms. And then one of the numerous elf castles in Spain, Santa Cruz de la Sierra, the megalithic blocks are also visible here. This site in Armenia could easily also belong to the same group. Why not? We see similar gigantic size, same style, polygonal masonry, and of course, nobody knows anything about it. Despite the stage of this deterioration of the elf castles, still we can say for sure they were not built by primitive people, even only based on the very size of the enormous megalithic blocks. That itself is enough. I don't know, can we even duplicate this? This site in Israel could be a transitional one from the typical Derenkuyu style underground cities to what I call elf castles, because it combines design elements from both types. It's not clear if the elf castle's builders were continuation of the civilization of the underground dwellers who cut the rock-cut cities, or did they simply find historic ruins and imitate their style or remodeled them? Vehicle tracks or something that looks like that seems to appear besides the elf castles, but sometimes they appear to be rather unusual. For example, at Belintash. Yes, it looks like vehicle tracks, but it is just too short. It is doesn't continue. Was some sort of equipment just moving? And here, did the stone melt and flow over one of the tracks? It is really not clear. Sometimes the tracks just turn into this type of markings on the stones. And then were the stones melting from something? Because here, as if they were molten when something hit. Maybe this melting explains this overflow here. The only similar thing I can think of are these, I don't know, tracks or what in Bolivia. Also found besides rock cuttings that make little sense to us. So all those rock-cut complexes in South America, like this one in Samaipata, and let's say the Baños de Inca, and then the Otuzco windows, and this unidentified rock-cut ruin in the middle of the ocean at Rapa Iti, were they built by the people who made the elf castles, or do they belong to the later category of cuttings found near the famous megaliths in Peru? And it's not just the fact that huge megalithic blocks are found at the sites of the elf castles. There is yet another clue proving that they were built by advanced society, and that's the very fact that some of them are actually very large metropolises. It's impossible to even see where they end. It's just kilometers and kilometers of ruins showing here and there. That's valid especially for those of Bulgaria. And since very often medieval forts are built on the basis of such older structures, usually people would think that everything is medieval. Or in some cases where it is more obvious, they would be satisfied simply with the remark that it was built on the basis of an older place of worship or something like that. It would be like pagan place of worship. And people simply don't bother to think further. Like, for example, wait a minute, from what we are told about these so-called pagans, they shouldn't have been able to build such gigantic megaliths. They were simple folks, right? For example, a relatively insignificant fort in Austria. It is built on the top of older rock-cut ruins. They spread even outside the fortress compound, and they are obviously not cut for the purpose of the fort, because, for example, this is the outside of the defense walls. I'm sure you will agree that stairways are definitely not part of what would you expect on the outside, where you don't want your enemy to climb. And there is no lack of such examples. Turkey, Italy, Spain, they are full of them. We see them all the way to Switzerland and Austria even. At the Elf Castle places, we see the first prototypes of the so-called Roman amphitheaters. And yet another one here, officially, they are saying, we wonder, was it built by the Etruscans or by the Romans? This is a very commonly used trick used to distract us from inquiring into the real history, giving us two choices to wonder, and they are both misleading. Because both terms, Romans and Etruscans, are highly misused labels. In reality, they both signify almost the same. The society, which was gradually degrading and losing the original knowledge. The examples of which we saw earlier, to use megalithic blocks the size of houses. But even if we stick to the Penguinian terms of Roman and Etruscan, just look at it. Yes, the gate definitely looks Roman. It so obviously looks like a patch. Do we need to be specialists to see this? Fluted columns on the very ancient rock-cut ruins? Probably everything was there, nothing was invented by the so-called ancient Greeks or ancient Romans. The columns are labeled as Etruscan, and so the problem of explaining them is easily solved. But here I want to show you an Etruscan, what would be officially rock-cut tomb. This time it is in Turkey. And of course the credit to it is given to some primitive Turkish tribe that surely could not have afforded to go on package holiday to Etruria and over there borrow a sketch for their tomb. Otherwise, how come both have absolutely the same design, even the border matches? And it's not just one pair. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of such design all over the Asia Minor and Southern Europe. And that is why in the modern schools, history is taught always fragmented, just bit by bit, separately for every region, so that students are not shown images of the same sites occurring all over the world and on different continents. Otherwise, they will figure out, look, it was all made by the same people. And I want to share just a small example of how such misleading labeling can be destructive to our understanding about history. We reached a small village in Spain where ancient vehicle tracks were supposedly found, but we didn't know the exact location within the village. So we started asking the villagers, and most of them didn't even know anything about them. We thought it's very weird because it was supposed to be kind of regional attraction, so how would you not know that it is in your own village? Ironically, at one point I was standing practically, I don't know, 50 meters away from them, still I didn't know where they are, and I was asking somebody and he didn't know. And then he figured it out all of a sudden. He said, "Are you talking about the Roman cart ruts?" And then we found them. This illustrates How much people get carried away by these official labels of the historic sites to the point that they don't even pay attention what is in front of their eyes. What we had at hand were very old ancient vehicle tracks. There was no ruin or any other hint around us to which culture would they belong to. And it always ultimately boils down to the same thing, faith, blind faith in what the history teacher told you. And blind faith means fanatic religion, it doesn't mean science. And the same with Atlantis, people are so brainwashed by the TV that this is some sort of legendary island, legendary meaning fantasy, non-existent, to the point that they don't want even to make themselves aware that there are whole lots of ruins staying there unexplored in the region of the Atlantic Ocean. And always, of course, there is some reason, supposedly trivial, as a rule, not to explore them. When any piece of ceramic with old looks is found in Europe and it can be labeled as a Roman, then thousands are spent on brushing it in the museums and keeping it tidy for the tourists when they come to visit. But when much more interesting Roman-looking ruins are found in America, always some local trivial reason will appear for stopping their study. Large system of ports lay submerged on the bottoms of the oceans around and in America. But very few people ask themselves why the History Mystery Bamboozle channel doesn't want to inform people about this amazing, in some cases, megalithic constructions on a very large scale. According to estimates, ports of this size and that many would be quite challenging to build even nowadays. Yet people believe that this type of folks build them. Of similar style are found in the Bahamas, in South and North America as well. This is in Ecuador, although they are not submerged, the style is similar. And probably a nice way to close the chapter of the rock cut ruins would be these absolutely massive rectangular pools. Rock cut. As usual, nobody has got any clue as of their origin. Has somebody tried to study the local legends in relation to them? And Atlantis does not seem to be a product of somebody's fantasy after all, because the history of it has been preserved in the traditions on both sides of the ocean. It is in the codexes of the native nations in America. They even call it Aztlan. Even the name corresponds to the same island and same story that has been preserved in Europe. So in the Native American codexes, we have a record of people escaping a great flood and running to the mainland from Aslan. And then on the other side in Europe, we have a legend. Of course, it has reached us maybe in a highly distorted form because it's from Plato. It means heavily edited, possibly before we get it. But the story and the name matches. And then in old chronicles from the region of nowadays Russia, we hear about this civilization then mixing with the locals, but they still kept the old name. It is clearly said that they were still calling themselves Aslanda. That's how the actual name is written without trying to translate it. And recently I noticed yet another place with traces of forgotten ancient civilization bearing the name of Aslantash. Tash is just an affix, like Belin Tash and many other Tashes, so when we remove it, it remains only Aslan. This is so close to Aslanda.
We don't have any confirmed dates about Atlantis, but from what we can gather so far, it might have met its end somewhere around 20 or 30,000 years ago.
There are no dates whatsoever for the rock-cut niches, platforms, terraces found all over from Japan to South America. On one hand, those of Europe appear to be actually of the style of elf castles. And yet in South America there appear to be a class, a type of their own, found along the megaliths there. On the other side, the Peruvian cuttings appear to be very fresh, as if recently made. Well, maybe this can be explained with the dry climate over there. They got very well preserved, but then these in Sri Lanka, they are also relatively fresh, although not as fresh as the Peruvian ones. And at the same time, both of them seem to be much younger than the European ones, which are so heavily eroded in comparison to this. So were a couple of different civilizations or cultures cutting niches that we don't understand? And then the Sri Lankan ones appear to be pressed in the soft stone, or at least that is the visual impression that some places give. While in Peru, definitely they look machine cut. Shame on us, maybe it's time to become aware that we know so little about our history. Look at this, we have even no clue why were they making stairs leading nowhere. And it's not just this set of stairs, there are thousands of such terraces and unknown things in Peru. In Peru their amount is just overwhelming. And if in Sri Lanka softening of the stone was used to make them, then in Peru at places something like this could have been used to destroy them, because at the Sacsayhuaman site, where anyway we have some evidence that probably some sort of bomb fell in ancient times, well, over there some of the niches appear to be destroyed by melting. And it is very important that we see such cutting marks on solid bedrock, not just megalithic blocks. Because many of the so-called advanced ancient tool marks found on megalithic blocks could be actually made by simple tools when the mixture of the geopolymer was still soft, like these marks from Sacsayhuaman. But when we have tool marks with digital accuracy on large chunks, hills made of solid basalt or very hard variety of stone, Then that is even more solid evidence of an advanced ancient civilization. It is also very interesting that whatever cut these niches, it was also polishing at the same time as it was cutting or scooping the rock, we don't know what. Exactly was it doing? We don't have such a technology nowadays. If we want to replicate this, first of all, we have to build a power plant next to it, because the machines that are needed for cutting and then polishing eat really a lot. And then we'll have to make special arrangements how to hang these machines, or how to get them near the cliffs, because one thing is to achieve the effect on relatively small pieces that can be moved within the factories or the plants that work with stone. And when you can't just move the stone pieces around, that's another completely different situation. Gradually, man started building more and more megaliths, polygonal megaliths, instead of rock-cut stuff. The era of the polygonal megaliths was either very short or it was concentrated just at few separate spots around the globe, because there aren't that many of them. Contrary to the popular belief, it is not necessarily true that all of the polygonal gigantic megaliths are very old. First of all, many of them appear to be freshly made, like brand new. Almost no erosion whatsoever. This cannot be blamed just to the dry climate of Peru. This is in Peru as well, same conditions, but obviously it is much, much older. Another point to consider is that at few isolated spots, people knew how to build such polygonal wonders, megaliths, up to a short few hundred years ago, maybe some 200 years ago. This is a castle in Japan, medieval castle. In the Survivor series, you can see shown in detail similar examples from Russia and France as well. But I don't mean that all of them are recent. Here in Pumapunku, we see some very old stones sticking out of the modern renovation. All the older parts of Baalbek visibly seriously eroded. The builders of the enigmatic, polished, ancient big megaliths did not mysteriously disappear and evaporate as the earth prepared to descend into the dark ages of ignorance and wars that we are currently living through. As people were losing their knowledge, gradually the big megalithic blocks could not be handled anymore by them, and they started making something like big bricks. As they couldn't handle that anymore as well, they started using smaller and smaller bricks, usually cast out of geopolymer, but not always. Eventually, they resorted simply to undressed stone. The historic Khmer buildings in nowadays Myanmar, also called Cambodia, are probably the best preserved example of this gradual degradation. Also pay attention how the corner is formed by curved blocks. This is a very common approach also in Egypt and in Peru. They appear to have been cut after they have been placed, or they were molded together, something like that. So gradually that turns into smaller and smaller brick-like blocks. Please have a careful look. These are not yet our standard bricks. This is pure polygonal masonry yet, although the blocks are already almost brick size. Here we are still somewhere in between megaliths and bricks. And finally, the transition to the bricks as we know them is complete. And the legends, our true history, give a detailed account of how and why all this degradation happened. We see megalithic masterpieces scattered over different continents, and yet they look like as if they came from the hand of the same builder. Yes, it could have been the same builder who built Oljante Tambo and Alajuyuk in Turkey, because this culture didn't have problem with intercontinental transport. They were advanced. Probably they were those who survived the destruction of Atlantis and continued whatever they could save from the old knowledge. Even as far as Australia, we see their signature, the extremely difficult polygonal stonework. The man who dismantled this wall from the Gympie Pyramid to relocate it could not even put it back together. The original stones fitted together with such precision that once taken apart, they could not be put together so well again, and they had to cut them a bit on the sides to put it together back again. But let's get back to the original builders. They were hunted down, they were at war with the enemies of mankind, and they were losing. They were losing the war badly, and also sudden climatic changes were upon the earth. Extreme climate appeared, probably then the poles froze, and they had to seek other places to live at. And then they started mixing with the uncivilized tribes that were inhabiting most of the earth. The tribes did accept them as their teachers and sometimes even gods. And it is these teachers that gave us everything that we call civilization. Have you noticed that always when we have these perfect, polished, precisely fitting, very big megaliths, usually we don't have carvings on them? All these designs and figures, they always come at the later stages when more recent cultures add them. This is Baalbek, before it was Peru, and here in Egypt. Not sure if the art was never there or it was destroyed, but we may have some curious, very old pieces of art in Turkey. It is a very peculiar and old style, and if it wasn't from the time of those teachers or gods, then they could be the earliest preserved examples of the art of the times when the teachers were starting to mix with the uncivilized tribes. Now, these ones are from Hattusha, but they belong to the older layers with the real polygonal masonry, not the Hittite Hattusha that you might have heard of. And a few more from Alajuyuk. We don't have many pieces preserved in this style, although it is very interesting and peculiar. And then we have in Mykhena. They must have really respected it. Was it there or did they bring it from somewhere? They have put it as an emblem in and built their whatever palace around it. Although it was already a damaged piece when they brought it, you can see the heads are missing, and still they valued it so much that they put it as their most prominent antique already in their times, even maybe. Now, there are a couple of pieces also found in some Turkish museums, very few of them. And they're amongst other artifacts, because officially they belong to, let's say, Hittite carvings or this style carvings, but this is completely different. It's not smooth, it's obviously different than the smooth statues we saw before.
On the other hand, the Hittites and so on probably based their art on those older smooth statues. Pieces like this being the examples of this transition.
The builders of the sophisticated polygonal megaliths also made lots of actually quite high-tech looking underground shafts, many of them megalithic. They are found in greatest concentration in Egypt. Almost every pyramid has an underground portion. And then the very few people who have seen the underground shafts in America describe them in the same manner. And they are definitely there in Teotihuacan, under Pumapunku, a large network below Cusco. Their existence is not denied, they are simply locked. We have one in Australia and a couple of them in Russia. And also in a couple of countries around Egypt, I believe Ethiopia and a supposedly Berber site in Sahara. And it seems that at all the places where we find advanced polygonal stonework, we also find elongated skulls. Some of them got studied and they don't appear to be fully human as well. And even when they look fully human, often they seem to be foreign to the area where they were found. For example, in South America, they would be red-haired. In Europe, it seems, according to legends, officially only legends, they would belong to foreigners who would somehow come and occupy always the governing positions. They would become kings, rulers, this type of people. And then we have another type of historic ancient ruins that sometimes it's even impossible to connect with any culture whatsoever. These are the stone quarries. These grottos from China are by far the most interesting example. They are vast, the full mountain is practically hollow. Here you can see the cutting marks compared to those of modern machines. And also this location at Crimea, very interesting. Two marks that cannot be replicated by our most advanced and modern machines. And no clue who, when, why. Group of other quarries that could be connected to certain cultures, maybe, but they have their own sets of unanswered questions. Sierra de San Cristobal definitely being the most interesting out of them due to its enormous size. And all we can say in terms of dating at this point is that they seem to be younger than the rock-cut underground cities because those got eroded, although they're underground, but that's not much. We have another type of ruins that occur mostly in Asia, but also maybe in this European part here. Actually, there are a couple of dozens in this region. Officially, they belong to the Bronze Age era, but in reality, they are too high-tech for the way Bronze Age has been described to us. And also, this one, they started excavating, they covered it back. This one, Arkaim, they tried to close down. This one, they submerged in a dam. And they seem to be connected with smelting metal. So most probably all this desire to avoid studying them could be connected with avoiding making it known to people that it was those gods and teachers Who taught the science of metallurgy to the simple tribal man? And it wasn't that long ago that we were sharing this planet with giants and tribes of dwarfs. Relatively well-preserved bones of giants are found practically all over the world. For example, in Sardinia, some elderly people still remember how they were taking out them from the nuraghi, never to be seen again. I always wonder if the Nuraghi of Sardinia are somehow connected with the stone circles in South Africa. Not only both are circular, but also they both like windows. And then also Malta, it is known as the island of the giants. Well, modern school children are indoctrinated that those are just stupid legends, there were no giants at all. That's all fantasy, but to say that these giant megaliths were built by some absolutely primitive people who found some interesting mud that was turning very easily into stone and they built all these amazing things, that's more of a fantasy to me. If even uneducated people could make such durable and actually stylish environmentally friendly buildings just putting mud together, then why are we killing Mother Earth, polluting it with our enormous cement industry, which is very poisonous by the way, and still we can't make it to look that beautiful and so durable? And then the dwarves managed to tolerate us even longer. We have much more artifacts and remains from them. And they're even still here now at some places underground. We have very tangible evidence from them in Central Asia, in Siberia. I put that in a special video. And then recently I visited Erdstelle. Sometimes they have rooms where we can fit, but they have such a tiny living quarters and tunnels that I don't know how people don't connect them with dwarves. Although I did not meet any dwarves personally during this visit, I think this hypothesis is really the best one because it's not just the passages and the doors of this size. The one we visited had a tunnel some 50-60 centimeters high and even more narrow, which went on for many meters, and my friend, he started getting worried because he was always hoping we'll reach a wider place where he can turn back. He's 175 high and very slim, and he had difficulty crawling through it. These are some actual artifacts found in the dwarf abodes of Asia. And to get back to our visit to the Erdstal, the question arises, if a slim and not very tall man cannot even walk through the tunnels, cannot go through them, then how he can hit with a hammer and make them? It was impossible to take photographs even with the camera that we were holding in our hands in this situation. Movements were that much restricted. So to assume that a human of our size could have been hitting a hammer in this situation is absolutely ridiculous. And then I tried to discuss this point with a historian, a very lovely lady, local to the area, but it was just like a wall immediately. Oh yes, we know about them. This is a mystery. This cannot be solved. This nobody knows. This penguin trick of the mystery, it really works very well. Once something is stamped as a mystery, any suggestion made about it, any hypothesis will be immediately considered fringe and aliens and nonsense and non-scientific by default, even if it is absolutely logical. So the case with the dwarves perfectly illustrates how, let alone the legends, even some stories that are printed in the children's fairy tales books are much closer to the real history than some of the nonsense taught in schools. At the times when those gods or teachers who survived the destruction of Atlantis were educating and governing as well the planet, there was a lot of international and intercontinental travel going on. For example, in the Survivors episodes, we reviewed tangible presence of black people in Europe. Often they had respectable positions as nobles and governors. Then we had considerable African and European presence in both Americas, and European presence in Australia and Africa. Those gods or teachers first were using the technique of casting, probably in the most cases, huge polygonal megalithic structures, and at later stages it turned into use of cement. This is a common sight at the old temples all over Southeast Asia, and that is a large chunk of the planet. Cement on the top of bricks. And then we have that very same cement used in Teotihuacan. It says extensive use, extensive. Few spots even survived the so-called restoration. That very same cement was used in Europe all the time, from Malta through the times we tend to call Roman, and then very few people actually pay attention that many of the medieval castles in Europe are cast out. But out of all historic figures, there is a single one most revered and most remembered. Jesus Christ. We don't even know how he looked like, or even when did he live. Although commonly believed that it was 2,000 years ago, I personally find the Fomenko's version of 1,000 years ago to be much more plausible. Well, that doesn't even matter, but it matters that we didn't manage to keep even a single original record of his actual teachings. But wars are like that. Books are lost. The knowledge is forgotten. And this war seems to be going quite a few thousand years already. Entire cultures seem to be buried under sand, like for example Egypt. Villages and entire temple complexes are found under many meters of sand. Doesn't look like a natural process of formation of deserts when rivers drag and grind rocks into sand for millions of years. And then what about those terrible large-scale epidemic sicknesses? Were they really all natural, or was it all engineered? And all those sites in Peru, Egypt and Turkey, where enormous megaliths are cracked and scattered around an epicenter, a typical aftermath of massive explosion. Well, most people prefer not to bother. They believe the teacher who told them that primates with spears caused all that, and they feel comfortable. Everybody else believes it as well. But for those who want to know the truth, even if not everybody believes in it, here is a very nice example. How can we find out the real history? It's not as difficult as you may think. Dmitry Nikulin is just a young lad from Belarus. His hobby is to research places of power. Now, from people who claim to have astral abilities, he has heard that they have visions around the Lake of Svityaz. They have visions of a busy town, although it is just around all fields, and this lake suspiciously round. Now, the official explanation of the origin of this lake is that certain earth layers gave into the cavities inside the earth. They basically fell down, and then a hole was formed, which later on filled in with water. The local legends tell a completely different story. They say that there was a town, city here, and these people, they had enemy, and when the enemies approached during war, the city started burning, and then it just fell into the ground, burned down, and then everybody who was touching the burned town also was getting sick and dying. Over there he found a bunch of old maps, which were actually surprisingly accurate. All the lakes, all the towns were there, supposedly where they should have been, except this one, this lake that he was investigating, that was nowhere to be found. Instead of that, there was a town, a city, where it supposedly it should have been. And that's not in some faraway age of dinosaurs, just a couple of 200-300 years ago. So why are they teaching these things in school, that in some far, far away age, when the face of the earth was forming, some layers fell down? No, it happened very recently, and the layers fell down because there was war. And think for yourself, what kind of weapon could make the city fall, like, immediately in the ground, and then whoever comes and touches it also gets sick and dies. And I'll give you a clue, this is not the only town and city that has disappeared under such a natural round crater, and high radiation levels can be still measured on some of them. And all this was happening some, let's say, 200 years ago. Even in America there were very strange fires at that time, like flares of flames were jumping over lakes, turning, flipping over even trains. And then officially we are told that the crops were burning. What kind of crops burn like that? And why this destruction? What was the target? Actually, under the extremely misleading term of neoclassicism, lay in disguise the last remains of the old knowledge of those teachers or gods. It wasn't just a decoration style born of the sentiment of nostalgia for the old times. No, people still remembered somewhat the old times. That's why they knew how to build those amazing polygonal megaliths. In the Survivor series, I have provided detailed examples for that with the megaliths of St. Petersburg and the aqueducts of France. Also, the megalithic pieces from Japan that we saw earlier, they are part of a star fort, not something extremely ancient. Some of the engineering masterpieces of that time are of quality higher than what we have nowadays. The star forts were built by people who still understood the practical meaning of sacred geometry. People who still felt to some extent the pulse of their mother, the nature, earth. And then the last few remaining molecules of that knowledge were lost during the times of so-called Industrial Revolution. I can't put it in better words than Jane Roberts did in her Seth books. That's why I will simply include a quote from her book.
In Western culture, since the Industrial Revolution, after about 1760, the idea grew that there was little connection between the objects in the world and the individual. Now, this is not a history book, so I will not go into the reasons behind this idea, but will merely mention that it was an overreaction, in your terms at least, to previous religious concepts. Before that time, man did believe that he could affect matter and the environment through his thoughts. With the Industrial Revolution, however, even the elements of nature lost their living quality in man's eyes. They became objects to be categorized, named, torn apart, and examined. You do not dissect a pet cat or dog to love it. So when man began to dissect the universe, in those terms, he had already lost his sense of love for it. It became soulless for him. Only then could he examine it, you see, without qualm, and without being aware of the living voice that protested. And so in his great fascination for what made things work, in his great curiosity to understand the heredity of a flower, say. He forgot what he could also learn by smelling a flower, looking at it, watching it be itself. So he examined dead nature. Often he had to kill life in order, he thought, to discover its reality. You cannot understand what makes things live when you must first rob their life. And so when man learned to categorize, number, and dissect nature, he lost its living quality and no longer felt a part of it. To some important extent, he denied his heritage. For spirit is born into nature and the soul, and for a time resides in flesh. Man's thoughts no longer seemed to have any effect upon nature because in his mind he saw himself apart from it. In an ambiguous fashion, while concentrating upon nature's exterior aspects, in a very conscious manner, he still ended up denying the conscious powers of his own mind. He became blind to the connection between his thoughts and his physical environment and experience. Nature became then an adversary that he must control. Yet underneath he felt that he was at the mercy of nature, because in cutting himself off from it, he also cut himself off from using many of his own abilities. It was at this point that the nature of the conscious mind itself became so misunderstood, and those unrecognized or denied powers were assigned to unconscious portions of the self by ensuing schools of psychology. There have been tyrannies propagated for various reasons by the race of man upon itself. One of the greatest, however, is the idea that the conscious mind does not have any touch with the fountains of its own being, that it is divorced from nature, and that the individual is therefore at the mercy of unconscious drives over which he has no control. Man, therefore, feels himself powerless. If the purpose of civilization is to enable the individual to live in peace, joy, security, and abundance, then that idea has served him poorly.
The Star of Words appeared on the stage of history relatively recently, yet here we see one buried under layers of earth, as if the great flood was upon it. I agree that it could have been some local violent landslide that caused all this if it was just an isolated case. But around that time, we also see areas of Siberia having their forest devastated, and that's in spots larger than entire countries. No mention about it in any chapter of the official history. And who is there to mention it when even the graves of the people at that time seem to have disappeared? After I published the material on why entire cities built in neoclassical style are also buried under such thick layers of clay, then I received a lot of response from all over the world. People on the Balkans, in Hungary, Budapest, and a couple of cities even in America reported the same thing. Entire quarters of towns built in neoclassical style are buried 1-2 floors, stories, below earth, and there is no explanation and often even no mention about it in the official history records. So if mankind is gullible enough to forget things that happened 200 years ago, do you really expect that the history of 1,000 or a couple of thousand years ago will be correct? Before finding out its true history, humanity will first of all need to cultivate courage, because lots of it will be needed for people to honestly face the fact that they have lived most of their lives based on wrong concepts. It will be psychologically very painful for many, because once we start delving into the question of who and why, tempered without history, what was the force that through the ages, from the Reformation till nowadays, manages to keep the secrets of the true history with such a persistence? Why is that so important? Many will simply give up the inquiries into this matter when they start touching the area that it's not just the history. Our full current reality is a fake one, imposed upon humanity in the form of a fake belief system.
It is commonly misunderstood nowadays that the historical estimations made by Scaliger regarding the timing of historic events has been confirmed by modern scientific dating methods. And this is very important because his estimations are practically taken as verified and proven scientific history. So it is worth investigating what this so-called history is actually based on. Is it science or assumptions? In reality, the idea that it is scientific is very far from the truth. And in this video, we will review very briefly the methods of carbon dating followed by dendrochronology. To explain why this is so, carbon dating, also known as radiocarbon dating, is a method of determining the age of an object containing organic material by using the properties of radiocarbon, which is a radioactive isotope of carbon. When an animal or plant dies, it stops exchanging carbon with its environment. And from that point onwards, the amount of radiocarbon that it contains begins to reduce due to radioactive decay.
Measuring the amount of radiocarbon in a sample from a dead plant or an animal, such as a piece of wood or a fragment of bone, provides information that can be used to calculate when the animal or plant died. So far, so good. However, the speed of this radioactive decay is unknown, and determining that speed is not so easy, So the way they did it was by taking samples from dead animals or plants.
Which have died at a time that is considered to be known for sure, and then from that calculate what is the rate of decay of this radiocarbon. One of the main events that is being taken into consideration while making these calculations of decay rate is the eruption of the volcano near Pompeii, which buried the entire city, along with its residents, under a thick layer of ashes.
Good. However, the date when that happened was not really known for sure, but was taken from the Scaliger timeline itself. It does not confirm it. It is taken from it to start with. You will find interesting information pointing out to the fact that actually Pompeii most likely was buried just a few short 100 years ago.
More information on this topic will be covered in future episodes. On the Roman Empire. Well, besides being based on the unknown factor that is the rate of decay of radiocarbon, to add to everything else, the laboratory equipment required for this method of testing is extremely sophisticated, and according to the opinion of the modern scientists themselves, it gives absolutely inaccurate results very often.
Actually, to test a single piece, the proper way to do it is to have it 4 or 5 laboratories do it absolutely independently, and then to publish the results in terms of a range, because we always get the results in terms of one suggested time. However, the laboratories themselves give a very wide range of time, but we do not get that information. We get what some so-called historian interprets that time range to be. This documentary about the survivors of Atlantis will concentrate upon the last couple of thousand years mainly. And since according to mainstream science itself, carbon dating gives normally an inaccuracy range of some 2000 years, that practically means it is absolutely inapplicable to the recent history anyway. Another problem with carbon dating is selectively taking samples, which means that, for example, a piece of bone is found near a building and is used to find out the date of the building. Actually, it is absolutely possible that the animal to whom this bone belonged lived in a completely different time period, and not at the time when the given building was actually built.
Now, a few words about dendrochronology, or informally known as tree ring dating. The idea behind this is that every year, the trees form rings, and they are very particular, changing according to the different climatic conditions. Different rings form, however, by different kinds of trees, and even the same kind of tree can be different if located in different areas. And that is why, to use this method to date a wooden object, we must be sure the wood has come from this very same area, and that it is exactly the same type as the one that the scientist has the chart for.
And now about these charts. For example, we have a 100-year-old cherry tree. To continue the chart further in time, we'll need to find another one that is 150 years old. So some of the rings will be matching, and in this way we can continue the graph 50 years further back in time. Then we'll need another cherry tree which was slightly older than the one we have, so some of the rings overlap, and so on and so on. What you see now is an actual dendrochronology graph. It contains many white spots. It features few kinds of trees, and since they all must come from the same area, these graphs are very difficult to make, And because they're broken, they're not continuous, at the end we can see that dendrochronology is becoming a very subjective method of dating. And it can be really used in very rare cases because the sample that is required must be big enough. And often when the builders in ancient time would use wooden logs, they will actually chop off a lot of rings on the side to make a beam, and that will make the dating very, very inaccurate, because who knows when was the tree alive, when did they cut it, when did they use it, when did they reuse it. So to summarize, three-ring dating is absolutely a reliable and genuine scientific dating method. However, its application is extremely limited.
Limited to the point that it practically has no value in confirming this Caligarian version of history as genuine. Because all the white gaps between the black lines on this chart signify unknown period, then these unknown gaps are adjusted in such a way that they will fit the Scaligerian version of history, and again we cannot say that they confirm it simply because they are based on it again. A great number of modern historic dating methods appeared in the recent years. Their sophisticated and very scientifically sounding names alone create the impression that many learned men have worked on this. In reality, they are all either derived from carbon dating or they are simply a variety of carbon dating. And that is why they all suffer from the fundamental problem of carbon dating. It is all based on unknown parameter, the speed of decay of carbon. I would like to take you briefly to that point back in time when the fraudulent Scaligerian history was imposed upon humanity with military power. Those were very turbulent times for Europe.
The royal dynasties were changing one after another. For example, in England, the Tudors were replaced by the Stuarts. In France, the throne was taken by the Bourbons. In Russia, the traditional Rurik dynasty was replaced by the Romanovs, who actually did not have any right to be on the throne. On the background, all these events were orchestrated by the parasites, who were applying the method divide and conquer. By that time, they managed to successfully lower the consciousness of the human race to the point that there was no need to kill them anymore. The people started killing each other. The actual intention and events of the Reformation are not the ones we hear about today. They are distorted, and the proof of that is the very inconsistent story that we hear nowadays. We are being told that the main reason for the revolt of the people was the unlimited power of the Roman Catholic Church. Well, as far as the popes being unpopular, that is absolutely true. However, as far as any actual ruling power is concerned, they didn't seem to have much of that at this point of time. In Spain, in the 15th century, even before the Reformation period started, the authority over the Inquisition was handed over to the king. In year 1515, the French king was victorious in a battle against the allied forces of the popes and Switzerland. After that, the French king had the full right to appoint the clergy and to manage its finances.
In more simple terms, he had full control over it. From that time on, even the Pope himself was obliged to consult the French king, even when taking decisions concerning his own domain. And even the official version of history agrees with the facts I just told you. Moreover, they tell us that at that time the clergy were as rich as beggars. Often they had to sell cattle to have something to eat. So all this talk of the unlimited power of the Pope is just baloney, because at this point, even according to the official history, he did not have much social influence or any other, as well as a matter of fact. Since the first official reason for the Reformation is no good, let's see if the others will make more sense. Martin Luther. He is considered to be a seminal figure in the Reformation process. So, he thought Christianity should be nearer to the simple folks, and he translated the Bible from Latin to understandable German language. And also he convinced the people that there should be no images in the churches, no statues of the saints. Also, there should be no organ music during church services, and also a ringing of the church bells. So, we are offered to believe that because of not liking organ music or church bells during service, the result was
complete devastation of entire regions, famine and disease wiping out most of the population of entire countries, war bankrupting most of the combatant powers, severe hardship on the inhabitants of occupied territories, and one of the longest, most destructive series of wars in European history, lasting for 30 years.
And do you believe that people did all this because of the style of music being played in the churches?
But let's get back to the list of official reasons for the Reformation. The next one is that people felt nostalgia for the old and pure form of Christianity. They wanted to reinstitute it again. That is one beautiful and elegant intellectual concept. However, intellectuals write books and envision educational projects,
while those who care not for books go to the battlefield.
When a peasant upheaval, peasant revolt in Germany started, the very founder of the Protestant movement, Martin Luther, did not support it. He was himself preaching that the peasants should always, under all circumstances, obey their masters. And here is a confirmation of his views in action, taken again all from the mainstream history. He ordered the governors at that time to kill the peasants who were revolting, quote, like dogs that are sick of rabies. So the more we read, the more we understand that it wasn't Martin Luther who caused this most bloody series of war. It wasn't the church music either, or the statues of saints in the churches. Since the real reason for these most bloody wars is very uncomfortable for the fabricated history, mainstream historians are trying to invent all kinds of artificial reasons for it, and one of it is a real masterpiece of human stupidity.
This is how some modern historians are trying to explain the bloody conflict between Czechs and Germans during the Reformation.
Too much masculine energy was boiling in their veins, and they had no outlet of this energy. I think this is a masterpiece of concoction. By the time this particular conflict was over, the population of Czech Republic had decreased few times. And then their energy stopped boiling, and that's why they stopped fighting.
Reformation was a very long and very bloody war. It was a purely political event. Why are modern historians trying to present it to us as some sort of intellectual dream about organ music and statues in the temples? The reason The actual reason is that all this war was about the parasites trying to break into pieces the empire of the descendants of the survivors and then destroy these pieces one by one. The parasites won the war, but they wanted to get sure that the empire and the knowledge of the survivors will be never resurrected. And for that, they decided to fabricate fraudulent history. And in that fraudulent history, they did not even mention the very existence of the empire. The rest of this documentary will be about the empire of the descendants of the survivors who kept the history about them alive. They remembered who they are, and they had still a great deal of the knowledge that survived.
Quotes from so-called very ancient books are enthusiastically provided in abundance to confirm the validity of the history preached in schools. The fact that all the originals of those often quoted books disappeared under very suspicious circumstances is never even mentioned. And at the same time, when really authentic, very old books surface in some way or another, they're neglected, avoided, ignored, or they disappear. For example, the famous Sinai tablets found in Romania, hundreds of them. And yet, when I try to trace any information of where are they now, are there any translations, text, anything like that, there were only brief mentions here and there that maybe 34 of them are in some sort of archive.
The original tablets were made of gold. However, King Carol I in 1875 needed the gold and ordered exact copies to be made out of cheaper material. This is well documented. They were carefully kept in a monastery, but once the current Romanian government managed to take a hold of them, they were immediately declared as not a genuine and locked up, denied any access and even inventory. The reason for categorizing them as non-historic documents was their looks. They did not look old enough to be manufactured in 1875. For example, these items from the treasury of Tutankhamun look to the so-called historians to be older, well over 3,000 years, However, the Dacian tablets do not look old enough for them to be made in 1875. Actually, the Dacian Sinai tablets are a very small tip of the iceberg. What to speak of few tablets? The full cities of the Dacian kings stay absolutely unexplored, buried in the ground. The excuse for not making any excavation is the lack of funds. However, that very same supposedly poor Romanian government has spared quite few millions to buy back artifacts that were stolen from those unprotected archaeological sites by foreigners who come there and illegally dig up the artifacts. And listen to this fool joke. After spending all these millions and buying the artifacts on auctions and other ways, they were carefully collected together and declared as forgery and locked up. And as of today, the villagers who reside nearby the archaeological sites of the cities of the real kings of Dacia, they often see mysterious vehicles, cars with foreign numbers who dig and find things very easily. Apparently, they come already very well informed where to dig to find what they want. Well, no wonder that Romania is yet another country where the local people simply do not believe the official history that they are being taught in school. Situation is the Rohong Codex from Hungary. It is declared absolutely unreadable. All suggested translations are quickly rejected. And I read some amazing stuff about it even. The so-called historians are trying to convince us that this is so unreadable that maybe it is not even a book. Probably it is just illustration with strange signs besides them, and not only books. Such so-called unreadable writings are found on a number of temples all around Europe, and there is no end to the explanations given to them. Like, for example, oh, well, this is not really writing. These were some special signs that the carpenters and stonemasons were using to mark their, materials. It's not really writing.
At this point, those who believe in the Scaliger version of history will probably object and say, no, it is not true that we don't respect the older books. There are some really ancient books that we have in original, and they did not undergo any editing by monks. And these very ancient documents would be the Vindolanda tablets found in England, and the Oxyrhynchus papyri found in Egypt.
Let's see, of what value, of what use can they be in determining our real history? First of all, the Vindolanda tablets. Fortunately, they are available online in a very neat way. A photo of the tablet and a transcription and translation next to it. There is no text that could be particularly relevant to the history, the way we are examining it, in the collection that is available online. In case there were tablets that were dealing with the history, they are not available to the public.
The situation with Toxerinchus papyri is different. This is a massive, grand collection of works, and most definitely many of them would contain historic information relevant to the subject that we are researching. Is the timeline taught in school true or not? Oxyrhynchus papyri are not available like the Vindolanda tablets, where you can see each tablet and the text and the translation next to it, which is normal because it's such a big body of literature. But even if it was, it would be of little use, because probably they would have dealt with it the standard way. And the standard way is like this. Always everything, all the historic figures and events, are to be squeezed in into the established already during the Reformation fraudulent history and historic timeline. Doesn't matter how well they fit or not, even if it sounds ridiculous, they will twist the translation and purport in such a way that it has to fit, and when it obviously doesn't fit, then they will declare it a mystery.
And with these so-called scanned historical documents that are nothing more than electronic text files, if photos of the original are not made available to the public, how are we to know nothing has been removed or edited?
And here is the latest fresh find along these lines, the scrolls of Herculaneum. Okay, so we have more really authentic old books. So, as we all know very well, the bureaucratic mechanisms that power the official academic establishment, do we have any grounds to consider that these scripts will be impartially studied and the official history timeline will be updated with these new finds? I'm not convinced, because they have excluded from history such a large number of finds without giving to the public any explanation, then what to speak of finds that they can hide so easily by simply hiding the books or giving fraudulent translations? In other words, this argument of those who try to argue, to say, you see, we have the mainstream history is based on some very old books. There are such which are officially accepted. This has no meaning, because there is no guarantee that the content of these books is available to the public and is indeed included in the official historic timeline.
In 2013, entire streets of Roman London were excavated. We hear from the newspapers that some 10,000 artifacts were unearthed. I don't know what is the situation now, but some 1 year after they were taken out, still we had photos of only 5 of them. I wonder why they were not in a hurry to show us what were these 10,000 objects. All of the museums in the world display an average of 15% only of their artifacts, and the rest is not available for public and for researchers. As a routine part of his work, the astronomer Robert Newton takes some old historic data of the movements of the moon, and much to his surprise discovered that the moon behaved very, very strange and very, very erratically for a certain period in the past, and then it simply stopped and started behaving again according to the law of physics the way we know them. That was quite a problem, and a special big international conference was summoned in London with the biggest brains in this field, and the conclusion of the conference was that these strange radical movements were due to some absolutely unknown to us energy that was affecting the moon for a certain period of time only, and then it stopped affecting it, disappeared, and we know absolutely nothing about it.
But the Russian professor of mathematics Anatoly Fomenko decided that maybe this reason for the movements of the moon is not that mysterious.
He took to the task of looking into the matter.
While checking how did Robert Newton actually place the historic eclipses on the timeline of history, he discovered discrepancies. The record of the eclipses was by itself absolutely correct, but it was inserted at the wrong place of the historic timeline. Why is that so? Because the old chronicles that contained the record of the eclipses, they did not use the current calendar, they had dates of their own. Now, those dates were converted into the current calendar using the Scaliger and Pitavius opinion of how history should have been. And that is how they ended in the wrong era. Then Fomenko tried something else. Instead of placing the eclipses in accordance to the unconfirmed hypothesis of Scaliger in the timeline, he calculated a different time of the eclipses based on mathematical analysis of the old chronicles. And when he did that, then everything fell into place. The moon again started abiding the laws of physics, and there was no need to invent any mystical energy explanations for a strange behavior because nothing like that happened. Then he thought, wait a minute, but the eclipses were placed hundreds or even thousands of years away from their actual timeline. So what about the other historic events in all these chronicles? Let's see what the history will look like if I place them according to mathematical calculations instead of assumptions based on the faith that the Scaliger timeline is correct. Initially, he could not believe the results himself. But later on, as he devoted many years of his life to studying the old chronicles and placing them where they should be placed, and personally visiting many historic sites, it turned out that no matter how revolutionarily and radically the new chronology was different, it still fitted perfectly in the old chronicles and the historic sites. Unlike the history taught in school, which needs to be stretched and it needs silly explanations to make all the artifacts and sites fit in it, and often it uses fraud and destruction of artifacts just to survive. Millions of people in Russia read the books of Fomenko and consider them the genuine history of their country and the world.
Many of the well-educated people in Russia respect and believe Fomenko. Just one example is Garry Kasparov, chess grandmaster, world chess champion, writer, political activist, considered by many to be the greatest chess player of all time.
Who invented most of what we tend to call civilization? Who invented all those things that we tend to attribute to a sophisticated and refined society? Everybody knows the answer, the Romans. They built magnificent buildings and also engineering masterpieces, all those water aqueducts. They had flowing hot water in their luxury villas. The layout of their metropolis is sometimes surpassed even our modern one due to the precise planning beforehand. This is the impression about the Romans created by the history textbooks and the TV documentaries. But even if millions or even billions believe a certain story, this by itself is not a proof that this story is true. So let's look at the actual archaeological evidence available and decide together, are there any grounds to believe this story or not? First of all, the architecture. The people, considering themselves respectable academics, define the Roman architectural style as simplified ancient Greek style. While making a rough copy of your neighbor's house can be barely classified as anything innovative, not to mention how questionable the very term of ancient Greek culture is by itself, taking into consideration that we have much greater number and far more impressive so-called ancient Greek ruins outside Greece. But what I find most interesting is that those very same so-called academics also say that the ancient Greek civilization appeared on the ashes, rose from the ashes of older cultures, like, for example, the Mycenae. Now, at the actual archaeological digs at the Mycenae sites, they not only found full-fledged water supply and sewage systems, but they had running hot waters even on the second floor of their buildings. So it wasn't, after all a product of the Roman genius, as the History Channel is loudly trying to assure us. Everything was already there in a culture that, according to that very same History Channel, met its final collapse some at least 1,000 years before the Romans even appeared on the historic scene. And then they classify the Mycenae as a Bronze Age civilization. Bronze Age? Then how do you explain the machine tool marks, the high-tech tool marks, on the Lion Gate, their main symbol? Similar tool marks are found all over the complex of Mycenae, and all those Bronze Age tools that you see in the museums in big abundance are not capable of producing anything remotely similar to this. The tools and techniques used here were the same as those used on the famous Egyptian and Peruvian megaliths. After the stones were placed or cast out of geopolymer, we don't know yet, after that they were shaped with a tool with one single stroke, so to say. We have not yet developed such modern portable tools, which are so powerful that with a single stroke you can shape rows of stones at the height of a couple of stories, couple of floors. Such tool marks don't go well with the general idea that we are given about the Bronze Age, and that is why they don't show you such images on the History Channel. Now let's return to that famous Lion Gate, which has become like an emblematic symbol of the very meaning of Mycenae. It's of a completely different style than everything surrounding it and appears to be broken even before they placed it. Probably it was an antique already when they made it a main symbol at the entrance of their city. It is of style commonly found in Asia Minor, especially at sites that are extremely ancient, sites that have abundance of such high-tech tool marks as well. The lions of Mycenae also appear to have a cutting done with a tool that is definitely not Bronze Age. To be frank, I don't see any grounds whatsoever to consider the Mycenaeans even a separate culture, what to speak of the impressive label of civilization. It is extremely unlikely that they invented anything at all as well. After all, we see here a degradation in terms of techniques and tools compared to the older megaliths from where they took their lion figures. And whatever they built wasn't of unique style of their own. Such cyclopean walls are a commonplace for the Mediterranean region and particularly Italy. This is the cistern of Mount Sinai. It is built in a style very common for Italy and especially for Sardinia.
The Mycenaean symbols, their griffins, are in no way unique or peculiar to the region. They greatly resemble the griffins worshipped and revered all over Asia and Europe.
Such high-tech tool marks are not found on Mycenaean sites exclusively. They can be spotted at a number of so-called ancient Greek sites. And here, every well-read penguin will tell you, oh yes, we know all that long ago. Of course, ancient Greek sites are often built on the basis of an older places of worship. And academics still argue who were exactly the people before that. Still argue? Let them argue to their heart's content, but why they're not telling the facts to the people, the facts about what they have actually excavated? Namely, up to 6 successive layers below each other, some of them eroded, means the building on the top was built after the previous one was already eroded, that means great spans of time in between the layers. And most importantly, with each successive and deeper layer, the quality of masonry work increases considerably. And it is not just the size of the megalithic blocks that gets bigger as the layers get lower and lower. Also the precision of the quality of the masonry work. And the chances of spotting high-tech tool marks, they also increase with the deeper layers. In other words, degradation, gradual degradation is clearly visible. Instead of that, they're bamboozling us with talks about discovering and innovating. And it is not just the false propaganda. They also actively cover up the valuable artifacts of the old civilizations. Here you see some cutting tool marks are barely visible. The lower layers are submerged under modern asphalt or whatever, cement. And all that is going under the misleading slogans of preservation and restoration. In reality, most of what the general tourist would see on the so-called ancient Greek sites are modern buildings, some of them artificially aged. And at locations where the so-called restoration has not yet managed to erase all traces of the real old stuff, we see things like this, for example, protrusions on the stones, identical to the protrusions found on the Peruvian megaliths, the pyramids in Egypt, Baalbek, the French aqueducts. And it was the same folks who built them all over the world. It wasn't the Bronze Age savages who didn't know what's beyond their village. This is a polygonal megalithic masonry from Greece. You will find almost identical patterns in Alajuelik in Turkey and in Cusco in Peru. These are clamps used on the megalithic sites in Greece, identical to those used in South America, Africa, Asia, Europe. So let's get back to the original question. Did really the Romans invent any of the goodies of what we call civilization, or not really? So what about the Roman water aqueducts, for example, built with such a precision that they are accurate to the millimeter? Interestingly enough, impressive big Roman aqueducts are found in abundance
in dozens, if not in hundreds, in America, mainly in Mexico. The penguins assure us that the colonialists built them because they cared so much for the locals. Did they? Strange that some of the aqueducts actually feed pre-Columbian cities like those of the Aztecs. It is also somewhat mysterious that the colonialists, who loved the locals so much that they did time travel to Roman times to learn how to build aqueducts with them, so after these loving people met the locals, somehow a very small fraction of the local population remained alive. And I would agree that the Roman aqueducts in America would be some peculiar curiosity of history that we simply can't understand or explain if there weren't hundreds, if not thousands, of Roman artifacts found in both Americas, as we're gonna see in the episode about both Americas. I would believe that the aqueducts are some sort of strange exception if there weren't what we call European-style ports submerged in the Bahamas, along with ruins of large platforms and foundations of buildings in a similar style. So this documentary is not gonna be like, oh, it wasn't the Romans, it was actually their neighbors. No, I'm gonna touch much more fundamental problems, like the fact that we have been indoctrinated into believing so many mistaken terms in which we try to define our history that sometimes we lack even basics like the vocabulary to start investigating what actually happened in the past. For example, the cities in South America were full of Greco-Roman statues. Again, we are told it was all done by the colonialists. Which colonialists? The ones that were burning people alive just to make them Christian? The ones who devoted their entire lives to fighting paganism? We're supposed to believe that those very same people made fantastic statues of the very same gods of the pagans, inviting women barely dressed and men wearing only a vine leaf, and put them on the top of their most respected social buildings in the cities. So, getting back to the Romans, this is how the mass media confirms the fraudulent history already taught in school. They show you like these mosaics with girls in bikini, and they tell you, you see, they were so advanced, they even had bikini, they invented the bikini at that times. And people watch that on TV and say, yeah man, it must be true, you see the old mosaic with the bikini. Without considering that nowhere on this mosaic is written that these are the first prototypes of bikinis. It's absolutely possible that the chicks had bikini even before that. We simply don't have images older than this. Since the Romans did not invent their own Roman togas, why should we think that they invented even their Roman underwear? These are Thracian images of people wearing those very same togas. And these were cultures that predated the Romans. And these are your Roman togas, which many millions of women wear even nowadays in Asia.
And although the outfits of the Thracians and the so-called Roman togas and the saris of India are absolutely identical, people don't even notice it. They are so accustomed to simply taking the official quackademic historic labels as some sort of science that they don't even bother to question.
And I'm not talking about some minor details, the so-called mysteries, small unexplained parts of our past. No, even the very fundamentals of the so-called history, of the official history taught in schools, does not match the artifacts, does not match the historic sites, and not only the ancient history,
even the relatively recent one, as much as a few hundred years ago. For example, guess which city is this? I'll give you some clues. This was a resident of this city. This is how it looks nowadays. The answer to the quiz is Tokyo. Did you get it right? I doubt, because these things shouldn't have been there. Because when in Europe, people were building in the so-called neoclassical style, which is yet another extremely misleading label, then Japan lived in almost complete isolation from the world. So blinded in their fanatic beliefs in the quackademic stories about history, people just assumed that they must have been built after Japan got open to the world. But is this really, possible? This means clearing up large parts, the very central parts of their traditional city, just completely demolishing all buildings. Nothing like this is recorded. But just imagine, is it really thinkable that the Japanese people, the traditional Japanese people, would have demolished their best traditional buildings without telling anybody, without recording it anywhere, bring a bunch of foreigners, which they don't trust even till nowadays, to build new centers of all their cities from scratch in a style which at that time is already going out of fashion? And this man, by the way, is Okubo Tosimiti. This is a unique photograph from a Japanese museum of one of the last royal samurais. He shouldn't have looked like that from the stories we are told by the quackademia. This is how real samurais should have looked like. That's what people think. Well, these are actually actors. And it's not just the style that shouldn't have been there if the official history was correct.
Also, there are megaliths woven within the structure of those very same buildings that should not have been there.
And not just any megaliths, but polygonal megaliths, very much like those of Peru, Turkey, and Egypt. There is no coincidence, even the clamps match. With the clamps on the megaliths on the other continents, which the official quackademia is indirectly trying to trick us into thinking that they are from some extremely old and forgotten civilization, disappeared civilization, lost civilization. Don't even bother to trace it. It was so far away in time. No, it wasn't so far away back in time. At least its end. Yes, the civilization might have existed for extremely long time, but its demise was very recent. And now the time has come to become aware that somebody has been seriously tampering with our history. And if we really want to know how things really were, we'll have to start recovering the true history almost from scratch. So, since we didn't have any luck with the Romans in terms of finding any actual proof that they indeed placed the bedrock of what we call civilization, let's try with some other famous ancient civilization. For example, the Indus Valley, also known as the Harappan civilization, its most famous site probably being Mohenjo-Daro. Official academics send it 4,000 years back in time. That's deep antiquity. God knows if those dates are true, because as we're gonna discover in the later episodes, anything older than 200 years is highly questionable, and anything older than 500 years is most likely pure fantasy. But let's, for the argument's sake, assume that these dates are correct. So, let's see what we read in the actual notes of the archaeologists who were digging at the site. Couple of distinct periods are clearly visible. Of course, it was a long span of time, so it is normal different cultures inhabited it. So, the very first layer, from the very beginning, from scratch, there was central planning. There was sewage, there was flowing water, there were wells. Everything was laid out on a plan, before even the city appeared. So it wasn't chaotic, just a settlement, and then a few more people joined and decided to make a well. Oh, then let's build a house. No, central planning from the very beginning. And not only the cities were properly laid with streets straight and everything, the full civilization was centrally planned. There were factories manufacturing various goods, and it was remarkably well organized. Certain parts would be manufactured in a given city, and then transport would be organized. The full manufacturing process will continue in another city. So we are already talking about well-organized infrastructure with complex components. This golden period ends abruptly by people simply dying on the streets. There is nobody to even bury them. We are told by the penguins that it is all mystery. This is a proven trick. It works to tell it's a mystery so that we can ignore the legends which tell us in detail what kind of weapons were killing people like this. And of course, now the full site is restored, improved. This situation cannot be studied anymore. The skeletons are no longer there. The destruction of the buildings also cannot be studied. Was there really an epicenter? As some say, we don't know anymore. One more evidence destroyed. Well, anyhow, and then the next culture comes and inhabits the site, Mohenjo-Daro. They have difficulty maintaining the infrastructure even, which they found basically ready-made. For example, the water supply system starts deteriorating because it lacks maintenance, the public wells don't get serviced fast enough, things like that. Then as few more cultures take over the place, it progressively gets worse and worse. They cannot maintain it, and at the end, it boils down to living in torn-down houses. Wherever the roof is still standing, they inhabit those rooms, and they even start using the houses in some of the quarters as burial places. In other words, the organized society has simply fallen apart, total decay. So I'm asking, where in all this do you see any progression, any innovation, any discoveries, any progress? None of that. Instead, we see a straightforward confirmation of the legends, which are, by the way, the oral history that has survived nowadays. It has survived the destruction of the old, authentic books. And not only the degradation proves the legends as more reliable history than what we commonly see on TV, but also the fact that knowledge comes in a ready-made form, really exactly as the legends from all continents describe it. Somebody comes and teaches the people arts, medicine, installs social law, establishes infrastructure, teaches people how to maintain it. There were no findings suggesting that before the Indus Valley civilization, in these regions, there was any sophistication whatsoever, any gradual formation of anything at all. It just came in a ready-made form. And in addition to all that, this swastika symbol was found in Mohenjo-Daro, an extremely ancient symbol of good luck and prosperity, which, again, strange enough, appears at various places on various continents where advanced knowledge all of a sudden appears out of nowhere.
Now, in terms of the role of organized religion in nowadays society, it seems that relatively few people actually meet God face to face after being members of a particular group. But there is something else that has been working very effectively. People's consciousness is flooded daily by numerous stories of people acting violently, led by religious fanaticism.
Because after watching TV for even a couple of minutes, one falls into the state of hypnosis. Although it is a light hypnosis, still it is, and the very definition of hypnosis is a state of high suggestibility. Well, in the episode about the religions, you will be surprised to discover that completely different times were upon us. Times when, for example, the Christianity and Islam were actually one and the same religion. As strange as this may sound nowadays, actually, there are a lot of artifacts pointing in this direction. Like, for example, European kings from Russia, from Germany, wearing Arabic religious inscriptions on their helmets and on their weaponry. Quotes from the Quran are inscribed basically along with perfectly Christian-looking inscriptions. While at the same time as rulers in West Asia, which are now classified as purely Muslim, they were minting coins and depicting themselves with Christian crosses and other attributes now officially labeled as purely Christian. The official explanation for all this is that, the Christian kings, they wore this design elements for decoration
without understanding their actual translation.
And the German king, he just lost his mantle, and then he was wearing the Arabic one because exactly at the time he lost his, they conquered some Arabic tribe
and decided to use their lovely mantle instead.
Really? The German king was wearing second-hand dresses from minor tribes he had no connection with? And as far as the coins, we are told that, you see, the people who minted coins, they just decided to copy European designs without understanding what's actually on them. Really? Was there such a lack of designs all over Asia? But of course, it is very rarely needed to make such laughable explanations. In most cases, the uncomfortable artifacts simply never reach the public attention.
And even when people do notice and think, this is off, this doesn't sound right, they don't even know what to make out of that. Because they are tamed by the TV to classify it as some sort of strange mystery.
Mysterious part of our past that we cannot figure out. And another very clever trick is to always present and study the history fragmented. Everybody is restricted to their own region. For example, runic writing is found in Europe, Asia, and Africa, and maybe even some variations in both Americas. Now, as artifacts with runes are found on the territories of different countries, they are labeled as completely independent writing systems so that people don't figure out that in the past we were all part of one big family. And then you might be wondering, is it really possible that so many historians over the centuries and thousands of years have made such blunt mistakes and imagined history disconnected from the artifacts and the historic sites? How is that even possible? No, it is not possible, but the timeline that your history teacher told you in school is actually a fiction mixed with half-truth, and all that was cooked mostly during the time of the Reformation, when history as such was transformed from a science of studying the past to a method of modifying the consciousness of the masses by making them identify with what they are actually not. When people got convinced that they are descendants of savages and monkeys only, they were no longer aware that they can claim their rightful heritage as both students and children in the most direct sense of advanced celestial beings. After most of the genuine historic chronicles were burned during the Reformation, often tossed in the fires along with their authors, then a new fictional history was compiled. It was done mainly by two people, Joseph Scaliger and Dionysius Petavius. Most of what is called history nowadays is based exclusively on the work of these two people. There are claims and speculations that their works was based on old chronicles indeed, but none of these chronicles has survived till now. So basically all we can do is hope that there is some truth in it. And as far as those old Roman and ancient Greek works that are quoted and taken as indisputable, trustworthy, holy truth, well, we don't have the original of even a single one of them, but we have copies. When the small group of Jesuit monks were making the copies, they honestly wrote in the preface, "We are copying and correcting to make it fit the new history." And after each and every copy was ready, a misfortunate fire would erupt in the library and burn only the original. But the newly made copies that were laying on the next shelf always survived the fires. What a strange coincidence. If you are to discuss this issue with a modern co-academic, he will tell you that Scaliger and Petavius simply did not have the time and resources to provide solid proof for the historic timeline they suggested, but somehow or other they must have been using some correct old sources because their timeline has been conclusively proven to be right by the modern advanced dating methods like carbon dating, dendrochronology, and others. Well, that is one elegant explanation, and that is why the next episode will be exclusively about those dating methods. We'll see, do they hold any water actually? Because if it did hold water, then why it is a commonly accepted practice in most laboratories who do carbon dating, for example, nowadays, to require, along with every sample submitted, a sample suggested historic period to which the given sample should belong. And the suggested date is always right. Isn't that fabulous? So out of all the expeditions that I had in mind for this autumn, only two will become a reality.
One is in Italy, that is going to start actually very soon, and the other one is a kind of a tour of Malta. First of all, why do I call it a tour and not an expedition? Because Malta is relatively, I'm underlining relatively, well studied, unlike Italy, where it is really amazing. Like, for example, the so-called pyramid in the Bomarzo area. It's not a question if it deserves the name of pyramid, but anyway, it is something. It was discovered just a couple of short years ago. What does it mean, discovered? It wasn't ever covered with anything. It was always there out in the fields, in the open, very easy to access, but nobody ever bothered to go there. Apparently, from what I can tell from distance, there is just miles and miles of rock-cut stuff out there in Italy that nobody has ever bothered to visit or study because the history is already figured, you know, it can be copied and pasted from the scientific Penguinian works already. So what's the use of, you know, wasting your time in the fields where local farmers use some rock-cut premises to store their tools? So at least compared to Italy, Malta is much better studied. We have at least a list of the locations where cartwrights are found, for example. Also, there is information that a couple of researchers did go around and tried to study them. I don't find their results particularly satisfactory, but still, I'm gonna call our future adventure to Malta a tour and not an expedition, because I see less scope of actually, less hope of discovering super fantastic new things. Basically, what we'll try to do in a week is visit all the ancient sites on this group of small islands. We may not have time to visit all the medieval sites because Malta is very rich in that type of history as well. So there is no guarantee that we'll see everything historic there, but at least I definitely plan to see all the ancient ones. Except the Hippogeum, I think at the moment it is closed and there is no information when is it gonna open again, so I don't know if that's gonna be included in the itinerary. We'll stay in somewhat better hotels, again relatively, minus four star, two of them, and one 3 star just for 2 nights. You can find their names on the booking page. In case some changes is required in the last moment so that we can fit all the old megaliths and vehicle tracks in 1 week and a change in the hotel is required, that then the hotels will be of similar standard to those listed on the booking page. And this time all transport is included, unlike the self-drive offer for Italy. This is a short tour and I would recommend it for those who live in Europe or somewhere nearby.
It is also an opportunity to escape the cold weather of December with this relatively inexpensive tour. Relatively, I mean compared to others of this type.
To those who live far away on other continents, I would recommend to wait for longer expeditions that I hope I will be able to organize early in spring next year. So if you decide to join the tour, you can go to the booking page and send the small deposit, and after that send me an email to malta@megaliths.org with a few sentences, few words about yourself, and then let me know if you prefer to be alone in the hotel room. That will mean single supplement, a bit more extra to pay, or you want me to find somebody for you, because I noticed that most people don't want to be alone but don't have anybody to take along from their home, so they expect me to find somebody. That will be probably possible, but then also mention it in case it is not possible, are you willing to be alone in the room? And then most importantly, after that, after sending this email, if you do not see a reply within 2 or 3 days, please check your spam folder regularly, because usually my emails get delivered, but once I tried to communicate with anybody regarding the Italy expedition, my emails were always sent to spam. I had this problem with everybody. Well, I think that's all for now. See you in Malta.
You say to me, I don't talk enough, but when I do, I'm a fool. These You're unbelievable. You're so unbelievable. You're unbelievable. Unbelievable.